Hey, brothers and sisters, how are you guys doing tonight? I hope everybody's doing all right. Yeah, I had made a few videos the other day, and I decided to make a new video. And I just want to add on here at the beginning a synopsis, a summary of my other video. And you know, the Lord had been talking to me like the 22nd, 23rd of August last week about judgment coming to the U.S. and all that. And the Lord gave me a whole series of stuff. And then the last thing that the Lord had showed me, he showed me that himself with a plumb line over the United States. And then when we see in the Bible where the Lord uses a plumb line, he'd given me a text. I'd looked it up. That was last week. I think there's several different ones, you know, when they measure the temple and all this. And then he said he'd use a plumb line. It seems like, is it in Zechariah 7:7 or 7:11 or something like that. Anyway, you know, it's when God's going to do judgment. You know, he's dividing the land, like the land of Israel will be divided. He's dividing the United States, you know, preparing for judgment. You know, the righteous people over here, the sheep over here, and the goats over there. So the Lord is preparing to bring judgment to the United States. And that's the message that I was on all week last week from the Lord. And, but it seems that, well, the Lord just gave me a new message tonight. And then when I began to look over what the Lord was showing me, I didn't really see how it applied to what was in my mind. But I see now that it does, and really it's like, you know, we have to have balance, brothers and sisters, and you guys have been, you know, I get new viewers all the time, and if you guys have been watching me since I started my channel, you'll see that probably, you know, the vast majority of my videos are really about grace and all that. And the biggest thing that the Lord has used me on YouTube to contend with is legalism. You know, people trying to keep the law, you know, self-righteousness in the law. And then less of my videos, and I don't know what percent, maybe 25%, let's just say 75. Of course, I make videos about the orphanage, but besides those, if you remove those, 75% of my videos are grace. And then when those who are, you know, and I not always, but usually I'll get some, you know, feedback from people who don't know me, who see the videos, who are trying to keep the law, you know, and they'll have something negative to say. And then the people who are what I call greasy gracers, you know, hyper grace people, they will say, yeah, yeah, amen, amen, you know. And then when I make a video about repentance and holiness and righteousness, I think it's Titus 2:15, you know, let me look that up. And I talk about, you know, holiness, like I just made a video, Romans chapter 6. I got some new people that had never seen me. And then, you know, I got those greasy gracers, those hyper gracers all in uproar. Because people only watch one of your video, but you know, I'm just like a pastor to lots of you guys. And then every week, you know, you can't discuss every topic and every point, every video. So, you know, there has to be, you know, if you, someone you're watching them regularly, someone is your pastor, you know, if you listen to them for a whole year or how many years, you're going to pick up all these different points. You know, you can't learn everything in one preaching session. So, where am I at? I'm going to be looking at Ephesians. I'm talking about the armor of God, but this is, I just thought about it now. Seems like it's in Titus. There's lots of different Bible verses, and I usually don't like to look at Bible verses while I'm talking. All right, let's go. All right, and anyway, so I wanted to look in, you know, I was thinking about why I was going to talk about something about the armor of God. Titus chapter 2, verse 11. For the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men. That's the Lord Jesus Christ, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world, looking for that blessed hope, the glorious appearing of the great God and our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. So, and he goes on to say, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify unto himself a peculiar people zealous for good works. I made a video mentioning this verses the other day. Just thinking about it now again. So, we're supposed to live denying ungodliness and worldly lust. We should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world. Now, to all you hyper-gracers, and all of you people who believe you say a prayer one time and live any way you want, the Bible clearly teaches we should sanctify ourselves unto the Lord. And it says that, you know, the Bible says God's goal for us is to conform us to the image of Christ. That's another Bible verse. And of course, our goal ultimately is to bring glory to God. The purpose of man is to bring glory to God. And that's by sanctifying ourselves. There's two, and I've talked about this all the time, there's two types of sanctification. Negative sanctification and positive sanctification. Positive sanctification, fasting, praying, reading the Bible, praise and worship, fellowshipping with our fellow believers, as the Bible says in Hebrews, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together. Where two or more are gathered in my name, there I am in the midst of us. So if you have two people or more gathering together, it's already the church right there. You can meet in somebody's home or whatever. You know, home churches are a great thing as long as you have an elder, at least one elder, who is not going to lead you into a cult. That's the problem with when you have a home church, too. You have to be careful of cults in a small group. But it can also be the greatest place where God will move, in a small group. So you have the negative and positive. You have to have the balance. That's what I'm talking about this video. You have to have balance. You know, you need an elder, a leader who's called to be a pastor, but you don't need an overeducated idiot. You know, you don't need someone who gets so educated that they stop believing the Bible in the education of man. As a matter of fact, where I'm from, there's Wake Forest School of Divinity. And, you know, I went to school and knew people who I went through my bachelor's program with through Assemblies of God. And then one of the pastors there, his son, went on to a higher level to go for his doctorate. And, you know, it's a seminary there and a doctorate. He wanted to go on to a doctorate in theology at Wake Forest University, and all of the professors and all the teachers are atheists. So bad that this guy had to drop out of the program. I mean, they were going to fail him because he defended the inerrancy of the Word of God. And he ended up having to drop out and go to Assemblies of God. Actually just started, that was in 2004, 2005. They started a master's. They have a master's of divinity, but they still don't have a doctorate program there. But you know, he went through them and finished, I guess, his master's, and then, I don't know, I guess he went on. I didn't follow up with him after that. But the point is, that's why they call them cemeteries. Even all of these, as a matter of fact, one of the most liberal up there, a lot of people think it's not liberal because Billy Graham went there, Wheaton Bible College. If you guys know, when I gave my testimony before, I think I mentioned in the videos, when I went into the hospital and prayed for some people, and they got healed, and I led some people to the Lord. And the hospital chaplain was a woman, and she was there watching me. And it was really like a miracle, people getting saved and people getting healed off the deathbed. And this one family, I think I talked about just a few months ago or weeks ago in a video. But anyway, the woman, she didn't even really know how to lead someone to the Lord. And she had a master's degree from Wheaton College. And I have a relative who's a Baptist preacher. And I was telling him about it, and he even went me to the hospital and introduced him to the chaplain. He's like, well, she went to Wheaton. She should know about the gospel. Well, if you go research on Wheaton, even when Billy Graham was there, because I was studying, you know, some quotes of different people, and then Billy Graham as an example, you know, one reason why he loved Wheaton was because of their open-mindedness to ecumenicalism and all this. That was way back in whatever it was, like the 30s or 40s, whatever, in the 30s and 40s. He loved their ecumenical mindset and their openness to, you know, more of a liberal theology, even way back then, way before it became cool in the 30s and 40s for evangelicals to become liberals. Anyway, I guess I should cut this video off and make a second video about Ephesians, brothers and sisters. The point I wanted to make in this video is balance. Balance, balance, balance in your walk with the Lord. Let me go ahead and just do it all in one video, hey. You know, I have a desire that to cut it short because maybe more people would watch it. And not because I want numbers, but because they would hear the message. If someone sees it's a 30-minute video, oh, they'll just skip over it, especially a lot of younger people, and then they won't hear the message. And, you know, and the message that the Lord would give me is for anyone who has an ear to hear. It's from the, you know, from my spirit, from the Lord, putting it in my spirit. Anyway, so Ephesians chapter 6. Tonight while I was praying, the Lord was showing me He was showing me about our feet, you know, being prepared to carry the gospel. And he was showing me, you know, when you're going over a rocky road, if you're barefoot, it's going to hurt. You know, you have to have on your shoes. And so I just wanted to talk about that a little bit because it says right there, I just want to talk about that one piece of the armor of God. And it talks about in verse Ephesians chapter 6, verse 15, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel. Now, you know, the Bible says how beautiful are those whose feet who carry the good news. Yeah, it's from back there in Isaiah, I believe Isaiah 52, maybe. I want to say Isaiah 52, Isaiah 52, 7. So, this one piece. So, the point about that is carrying the gospel of peace You know, because Paul, in the whole story of the armor of God, which I need to do a whole video about it, several people have asked me to, you know, he's comparing it to a Roman soldier. You know, talking about a sword and a shield and all that stuff. So at the time of Paul, you know, it's the time of the Roman legions and all that. And so they used to wear these things on their feet and for the battle. And it prepared them, you know, to protect their feet from rocks and all that kind of stuff. And it was part of their uniform, and they could to run swiftly toward the battle. So, you know, if you don't have peace, if you lack peace, because it says your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. I mean, if you're lacking peace, you cannot go into battle. You know, in other words, if you're like, you're not sure who you are in the army, you know, you're running out there and you're like, well, is the army behind me? Is the commander behind me? You know, let me say it more simply and not metaphorically. Is the Lord behind me? Am I forgiven? Am I saved? Am I walking with the Lord? Will the Lord be there for me? So, you know, there's not a people of having a lack of faith. One way the devil gets people, one of the biggest ways that the devil gets people is to steal their peace. And so what does the devil do? He tells people that they're not forgiven of their sins. They're not really saved. Where the Bible says his spirit bears witness with our spirit that we are sons of God. I quote that all the time, Romans 8:16. So one of the people that will not enter the kingdom of heaven, it talks about in Revelation, you want to talk about people not entering the kingdom of heaven. It says drunkards, okay? So when you read in the Bible, as I mentioned before, a little wine is good for the stomach. You have to have balance because it turns around and says that drunkards will not enter the kingdom of heaven, okay? Or nor effeminate, which is homosexual males, a girly man, a homosexual male, will not enter the kingdom of heaven. In that same text there in the book of Revelation. And then it says the fearful will not enter, you know, the fearful will not enter the kingdom of heaven. So the opposite of faith is fear. The lack of peace is fear. So in other words, if you read the Bible, and that's why I say these things all the time, like even the videos I've been making about repentance and the judgment of God, and I mentioned about smoking and all that stuff. It says, you know, I quoted that verse. It says, if we confess our sins, he is just and faithful to forgive us and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. 1 John 1:9. So you have to have faith in the name of Jesus, and faith in the blood of Jesus, and faith in the grace of the Lord. Jesus said, no one who comes to me will in no wise cast out. John chapter 2. I can't remember the verse number. But it's from John chapter 2, maybe 15, somewhere only there. So the point is, brothers and sisters, you have to have balance. Yes, we need to walk in holiness. Yes, you know, we're not supposed to be willfully sinning. But John tells us in 1 John, along in that same text where I'm talking about John chapter 1, verse 9, along in that same text, he says, if we sin, we have an advocate with the Father. You know, and then who is the advocate? The Lord Jesus Christ. And then Paul tells us there's one mediator between God and man. That is the man, Jesus Christ. He is the only mediator between us and God. And, you know, and people use that using when they're talking about like Catholic priest and all that kind of stuff. Or even someone's asking a preacher, oh, can you pray and talk to the Lord for me? You know, the mediator between you and God is the Father. Now, the Lord uses preachers to help teach us and pray with us and guide us into prayer and things like that and counsel us. That's all true. But in the place of seeking grace, you have to repent for yourself. Anyway, brothers and sisters, we have to have, if we don't know that we're forgiven and we're unsure of our stance with the Lord, then we have no peace. And therefore, we're not fit for battle. You know, and I can do a whole video, and I need to, on each piece of the armor of God, as the Lord would lead me to make it. But right now, I'm talking about peace, a lack of peace, that you're not prepared for the battle. And peace comes from balance, brothers and sisters. You have to have balance, okay? And as I say, this is the two groups I deal with. I deal with those who are hyper-gracers, greasy gracers, who need to be told they need to repent. Now, when I make those videos, like the ones I made the other day, about the lukewarm church and telling the people they need to repent, you know, they're going to be left behind and all that kind of stuff. People who are living in sin, they're going to be left behind. That's for your hyper-gracers. God gives grace to the humble, but he resists the proud. So those people, the very ones who message me and they're worried to death about being left behind, and you shouldn't have fear. But, you know, they're seeking repentance. They're seeking the Lord. These are the very ones who don't need to say the, you know, they're the very ones that I don't, that I shouldn't have to talk to. It's those ones who don't want to be told they need to repent. You see what I mean? So this is two sides we deal with, brothers and sisters, the hyper-gracers and then the legalists, people who think you got to be perfect. We will never be perfect, brothers and sisters. As long as you're in this flesh, we will sin. As Paul said, you know, I do the deeds I don't want to do. You know, even though, you know, what a wretched man am I, but thanks be to God, you know, I can be, you know, I'm saved through Jesus Christ, or I'm not quoting exact words there. But then he starts talking about the gospel. So when we repent, we are forgiven. And it's not, you're not, you know, the balance is, it's not that you pray one prayer, you're forgiven for past, present, and future sins, and then you go live like hell and go to heaven. No, you're forgiven, you're repented, and you begin anew. All things become new. You start new, and you walk with the Lord. As I said in my video, Enoch walked with God and he was no more because God took him. That is our example of the rapture, to walk with God. In Revelation chapter 3, verse 10, Jesus told one church out of seven that he wrote to, the church of Philadelphia. Revelation 3:10, he said, because you have patiently kept my word. King James says, because you've kept the word of my patience. But in the, you know, in the proper English order of speaking that we use today, Jesus said, because you have patiently kept my word, I will keep you out of the hour of temptation that will come upon the whole earth to try all of the people, mankind. So that's the tribulation period, to be kept out of it. Luke chapter 21, verse 36, Jesus said, watch therefore and pray always that you be kind of worthy to escape these things. And what things? The tribulation is what he'd been talking about in Luke 17 and Luke 21. And stand before the Son of Man, he said, to be kind of worthy to escape these things. And stand before the one Son of Man. Pray ye always. So now the greasy gracers, the hyper-gracers, will say again that Jesus didn't, you know, wasn't really saying that you need to pray always. He's saying that, you know, once you get saved, then you're kind of worthy to escape. And I don't agree with that. And the Lord has led me on that, even though I used to say that. But in the last 6 months or year, the Lord has moved me to a different position, as the Lord has led me by, you know, understanding and by His Spirit, by the parable of the 10 virgins and all that. The Lord has shown me that, yes, that is the church he's talking about, as the Lord has led me. But I'm trying to get to the other side of this. Brothers and sisters, once you repent, you are forgiven. And if you, Jesus said, if you sin 7 times 70 times a day, you repent and God forgives you. I'm trying to address the elephant in the room here. I mean, it's. I need to make a whole video unto itself. I just want to say this. If you, I've made videos about this in the past. It's a complicated subject, brothers and sisters. It's a very complicated subject. Let me just say this. Jesus said, you've heard it been said. In the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus said, you've heard it been said. If you, thou shalt not commit adultery. But I say unto you, any man that's looked on a woman with lust, and with homosexuals, another man, I guess, women looking on a man. If you've looked on another woman in lust, you've committed adultery in your heart. So, even though we can look away, as Jesus said, if your eye offends you, pluck it out. We sin every day, and people have committed adultery in their heart. Jesus said, if you hate your brother without a cause, you've committed murder in your heart. So, we sin, even in our heart, thoughts and intents of our heart, brothers and sisters. And I just want to say this, and I made videos about this in the past. And it's so funny that the greasy gracers, the Baptist types, are the ones to make the biggest deal about it. But the holiness people are the ones who embrace grace and forgiveness when people repent more than your greasy gracers. That's what's so hilarious when they say you're forgiven of past, present, and future sin. But somehow they try to say that divorce is the unforgivable sin. You know, and so I made a video before, you know, divorce people, God's not finished with you yet. I've made two different videos about it. Divorce is not the unforgivable sin. You can get divorced, brothers and sisters, even though it's a sin, except for in the case of adultery. You can get divorced for any reason, and it is a sin other than divorce, other than adultery. But by the grace of God, you can repent of it, and God will forgive you. It says He will cleanse you of all unrighteousness. The Bible says, and people quote this all the time about salvation, from Isaiah, as far as the east is from the west, so your sin will be from you. The Bible says God cast our sins into the sea of forgetfulness. Now, if God's forgotten it, and God has cleansed you and washed you and all this, then your marriage is in the past. Your divorce is in the past. It is over. Even as, look, I could go on and on and make a whole video about this. When Jesus was talking there that people love to quote, and he said, Moses allowed you get divorced for the hardness of your heart. But it was not that way from the beginning, from Adam and Eve, not just with the New Testament, from the beginning. You know, it says the man and woman should become one flesh, and what God has joined together, let no man tear apart. So God's will, just like any sin, God doesn't want us to sin in any way, including divorce, because it says let no man tear apart. But yet, people do tear it apart. They do get divorced, and it is bad, and it is a sin. But God's not saying that you can't. He's saying that he doesn't want you to. It is a sin to get divorced, but people do. And when we sin, as John tells us in John chapter 1, we have an advocate with the Father. That's the Lord Jesus Christ. And if we confess our sins, 1 John 1:9, he is just and faithful to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. We are cleansed, brothers and sisters. We are cleansed. We're free. There is not the only unforgivable sin is blasphemy of the Holy Spirit. And then many scholars will tell you that the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit is when Jesus walked the earth and then Jesus did something and you said, oh, it was done by the power of Beelzebub instead of God. That's blasphemy of the Holy Spirit. But, you know, there are other people that say that if you see someone, you know, speaking in tongues, you say, oh, that's a demon, then you're blaspheming the Holy Spirit. Now, that's open for debate. And that's why I didn't want to touch on that. People worried about the unforgivable sin. If you mention it, they can't listen to the message. That, ooh, Zoom, I think I've committed the unforgivable sin. Here's a lesson for you. If you've committed the unforgivable sin, the Holy Spirit would not strive with you. God would not deal with you. You would have a reprobate mind, and you could care less about the unforgivable sin. It would mean nothing to you. But since you're concerned and worried about it, it says that the Holy Spirit is bringing conviction in your heart about sin. Therefore, you have not done it, despite proof of you desiring to please God. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I've been all over the place in this video. You know, I can't cover every point. I made videos about this in the past. And like I said, it's so bizarre and surreal that the greasy gracers, who the hyper gracers, they are the very ones, and then denominations that aren't even saved, Roman Catholicism, they're the very ones who make a big deal about divorce. But yet, it's the Pentecostals who teach holiness and sanctification, are the first to embrace people when they repent. And that's what Jesus did. He embraced people when they repent. You know, it's just like this, brothers and sisters. You can't always do penance. Penance is not repentance, but penance is like you pay back. So in other words, like Zacchaeus, when he had done people wrong in doing the taxes, you know, you learned that song in Vacation Bible School, you know, Zacchaeus was a wee little man. A wee little man was he. He climbed upon the sycamore tree for the Lord he wanted to see. You know, and so when the Lord went to Zacchaeus, when the Lord stood there with Zacchaeus, and Zacchaeus was a little short guy, he said that if I've done anybody wrong, I'll pay him back fourfold and all that stuff from the law. You know, so in other words, if you've been divorced and then you're still single and then your ex-husband or wife is still single, yes, you could reconcile. Or try your best to reconcile. You still might not be able to reconcile. Suppose you don't know what's the situation. As an example, brothers and sisters, Jesus said, except for the case of adultery. Now, if two people get separated and then they get divorced, or even before they get divorced, one of them, even if they got separated because they keep fighting and getting drunk and whatever's the reason, not even adultery, they got separated. And then later on, they're single again from their divorce, then they get a new girlfriend or boyfriend, and then they sleep with them. Now, you know, it could easily be interpreted that once you commit adultery, or you know, you sleep with another person, your marriage is broken. The marriage vow is broken. That marriage is broken. And only if you both agree to reconcile is it reconciled. Once you have sex with another person, you've broken that vow. You've broken that marriage. It's only if you both agree, let's work it out, you work it out. If not, it's already broken. I mean, a piece of paper from a court is a secondary thing. You know, being that sexual unfaithfulness, adultery, has already nullified the marriage to me. Spiritually speaking, your marriage is already annulled, broken, divorced by the act of sleeping with another person. So there you are. You've already committed adultery, and therefore you have grounds for it. It's broken. And most people, you know, if you just want to look at it, all these different ways. I'm trying to talk to people. brothers and sisters, it doesn't matter. If it was, you know, this is just such a complicated situation. If you are remarried and you have kids with another person, and your ex-husband or wife is remarried and has kids with somebody, now you talking about, you know, a whole two more new divorces, you know, two more kids, sets of kids messed up, all this quagmire of a mess. Do not do anything like that unless the Lord, if you're 100% sure the Lord is leading you and your ex-husband or wife to do the same thing, you know, that's what you're going to try to do, go back and reconcile. And it'd take miracles of God to do that. You know, that your new husband or wife would also be convicted, yeah, that's what we need to do. And then the other person's husband or wife be convicted, that's what we need to do. You know, and then, you know, and you don't hear about that happening. God can do anything, and that could happen. But the thing is that people out there are, you know, they're all tore up about it. People are really, you know, way off the deep end. I've been in the ministry for 14 years, and I've dealt with lots of people in this situation. And there's always someone that comes along, you know, that told them that, oh, you're going to hell if you don't divorce your husband or wife. As a matter of fact, usually it's women. There's a sister from Ohio was the last one, I guess, I talked to. All tore up because someone told her she needs to divorce her second husband of 28 years and go back to her first husband, who she hasn't seen in 28 years or whatever it's been, years and years and years, who was abusive to her. You know, and this person was tore up because this person sincerely wants to please the Lord and do God's will in their life. You know, people who are really Christians want to do that. And you're dealing with impossible, you're putting, it's like a hopeless situation. If God never puts us in a place where there's no way out, where it's just totally hopeless, and it's just like something that's an impossibility because everyone has a free will. You know, it's like an impossible situation to put someone in. It creates a situation where divorce and remarriage become unforgivable sins. And this goes against the whole concept of the good news and the gospel of peace. It goes against the whole concept and the good news of the gospel of peace. Now, I don't want any, you can do what you want. I'm saying here on my channel, I don't want any self-righteous people who've never been divorced, you know, because, but you know, maybe, I'm sure that if you've got eyes, you've looked on another man or woman with lust. So you've committed adultery in your heart, but you may not have been divorced. You know, about half of all people in the United States have been divorced. Okay, half have not. So, you know, it's easy if you haven't been in that sin to start attacking people. Just like there's a brother who messaged me all the time. He's trying to come out of homosexuality. Okay? And he's trying. And he needs to do it. He needs to come out of it. But he's trying. And so for people that are not home, have not been, you know, have that, whatever you want to call it, that temptation, that spiritual force attacking them of lust, of homosexual spirit, whatever it is, lust, homosexuality, whatever, any both, whatever. You know, if you haven't been in somebody's shoes, you know, as Jesus said, he who is without sin cast the first stone. And that's the thing. So that's why I'm saying this now, just to be a balance to the videos I've made. I made those videos as the Lord led me, but the message at the end of it was repent and the Lord will forgive you. I put a bubble on the bottom of the last video I made, the hardest video I ever made, and it's for half the video saying, 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, he is just and faithful to forgive us and cleanse us all in righteousness. Repent, repent, repent. That's always, you know, the end result is you can repent today and be forgiven. Not no, go jump over a wall, climb through a tree, you know, go back in time in a time machine and undo and redo what you did 20 years ago. You can't do that. It's not possible. And God is not going to ask us to do anything impossible. He won't put us in a hopeless situation. That's why maybe some of you even feel, you know, suicidal and stuff about some kind of stuff like that. God would never do that to you. God never does that to his people. There's always light. There's always hope. All you have to do is repent. Confess your sins. And God will cleanse you all in righteousness. If, like I said, there is, you know, if God's going to make a way for you to go back to the other person and all this kind of stuff, he's going to be the one to work it out. You can't do, you know, you can't control the minds and the hearts of these other people. You're talking about making them. God is not the author of confusion, but of peace. I've been going on and on. I've been trying to get this out and thank the Lord. The Lord gave me the wisdom to say it the right way. And I, like I said, I don't tolerate any trolls on here attacking. And I'm not condoning any sin. I'm endorsing repentance. And God forgives us and cleanses us. We don't have to go back and live in the past. It is a sin to dwell in the past. It is a sin to judge other people. Jesus said, judge not, lest ye be judged. Because with the same measure you judge, it'll be measured back to you. Like I said, I'm not going to tolerate. When I made a video before about the Lord told me that he's not finished with divorced people. He can still use them. They've been forgiven. He can use them for his kingdom. I had at least 10 Baptists send it, you know, comment and hate messages to me, even sending me private messages, cussing me out in the name of the Lord. Can you imagine? This totally wacky and this condemning self-righteous spirit because they've never been divorced. And some of them too, their spouses had cheated on them. So they had this special self-motivation and, you know, their own motivation, you know, from their own personal position to come out and hate against someone who had got divorced and remarried. And, you know, not from the heart of Christ, but their own heart. And so, you know, we always have to be careful of our own personal motives when we're, you know, if we're going to try to judge people and stuff. You know, like I said, if you haven't been in their shoes, then who are you to judge? You know, another man's servant. You know, so each person answers to the Lord. So, you know, I try to, even though the Lord has led me to make these hard videos lately, I always, you know, try to bring a balance, and it's, you know, it's repentance. The message is here's the sin and then repent. Not here's the sin and there's nothing you can do about it. You're going to hell, tough cookies. No, that's not how God operates. God doesn't operate like that, brothers and sisters. That's not the gospel. The gospel is good news of peace. Not, oh my gosh, what am I going to do? My life's ruined. I might just kill myself. I mean, because I'm in an impossible situation and I can't repent. It's an unforgivable sin. No. When you hear that kind of stuff, you know right off the bat, brothers and sisters, if you know the nature of God, you know his word at all, that flies in the face of his word to leave people in a hopeless position. God will make a way for you, and God gives grace to the humble, but he resists the proud. And I went, you know, You know, we try to err on the side of caution, but the Lord is a very forgiving God. And I pray, you know, that every video I make, and I prayed this before, that my video would bring conviction of sin, not fear, as some people are doing. You know, that's the whole problem with this, like this Ephraim Rodriguez's prophecy about the asteroid hitting the earth. It brings fear on people. And, you know, we should have, if non-believers should be afraid, and yeah, we need to repent. But it's not to bring fear on people in that kind of a way that's not repentance, but, you know, it's a subtle thing, brothers and sisters. There's a difference between scaring people with hopeless fear and giving them, hey, you know, you're lost and you're in this bad spot and you're the hand of judgment of God is above your head. But if you repent, hey, everything's good with God. Everything's cool with God when you move over, you repent. You see what I'm saying? So I'm just trying to articulate this the best I can and keep it in balance and keep it right with the Word of God. It's just a very it's a very tough subject to move forward in this area. But you got to have balance. And I thank God, that's why God put me on YouTube, to bring balance. You know, I mean, you can hear people, we can get words of knowledge, words of wisdom and all that stuff, but, you know, no one is infallible, even though the Pope says he is. And lots of the people on YouTube think they're infallible. And they can't make mistakes and all this, but we are fallible. We are humans and we make mistakes. We all do. We all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And so that's another thing. Lots of times when people are ready to cast stones and call people false prophets, it also puts pressure on people to be push themselves and making proclamations. You know, that's not necessary. You know, that people get all caught up in all this kind of stuff. And that's why lots of people ask me, did you watch this video? Did you watch this video? I don't usually watch any videos, brothers and sisters, to tell you the truth, other than, you know, I might watch some, not some people from YouTube. If I watch videos, it's like, whatever, I read the Bible and then I'll watch a video of a teacher who, you know, who's a preacher, who's a Bible teacher, and it's like the topic they're good at. Ravi Zacharias, you know, dealing with atheists and stuff in philosophical areas, whatever is the topic that I'm looking at. I'll go to those preachers who I know that's their area of expertise. And, you know, I'll check them out. I'm trying to think of some other ones that I could recommend to you. Bill Cloud. You're talking about some Hebraic stuff and things like that. He's a redneck from South Carolina, but he spent years studying under a rabbi to learn the Hebrew and talk about the Hebrew idioms and all this. And things like that. I mean, it just not on a specific doctrine, but just learning deeper into the Word of God and those kind of things. And then you have to balance it out, you know, with the law and grace and not get a lot of the people in the Hebraic Hebrew roots movement, they get caught up in becoming legalists and Judaizers. You know, you have to be careful. But you know, there's things to be gleaned from that without, you know, start wearing a yarmulke, you know, and start trying to speak Hebrew and declaring yourself that you're, you know, one of the 144,000 witnesses. But yeah, anyway, you know me, guys, I keep going on and on. I'm just trying to put all this stuff out there because somebody might watch this video, and if I made another one part of it, people watch that one and not this one. And, you know, what can you do? That's the medium that we're dealing with here on YouTube. You know, people get a partial. So that's why I always try to put everything in one video to complete a thought, complete a topic as thoroughly as I can run over it and go through it. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I tried to wade through this quagmire of balance, but yet, you know, we got to keep it right with God, but yet, you know, God always gives us that repentance, and there's no unforgivable sin other than, of course, really the ultimate unforgivable sin, as they say, of course, is not getting saved. It's really is unforgivable, you know, if you really want to look at it. If you're not become born again, then that's unforgivable. And then, of course, I blaspheme the Holy Spirit. And as I've went over that in this video, what exactly does that mean, and where do you draw the line of blaspheming the Holy Spirit? We know for sure if you said, oh, what Jesus did, the miracles that Jesus did was by the power of Beelzebub, that is definitely blaspheming the Holy Spirit. If you said about some preacher today, is that blaspheming the Holy Spirit? Maybe. Maybe not. So I don't want to get into that. I'm going to try to back up off of that a little bit because, you know, there are people who are doing stuff and it is by a false spirit. So, you know, the discernment comes in, as the Bible tells us, is if anyone calls Jesus Christ Lord, you know, or not. But then, of course, even in the Old Testament, God sent lying spirits himself to some of the prophets to trick some of the kings. That's what the Bible says in the Old Testament. So, hey, it wasn't the fault of the prophets. God did it himself because he was going to destroy that king, like a wicked king, or King Ahab. It's one example. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I've been going on and on. This is 40 minutes, and my viewership will, people who need to hear this will not hear it. So God bless you guys. I love you guys. I don't have no trouble with anybody. You know, by the grace of God, pray for me that I won't let debaters and trolls get me all fired up, that I will, you know, minister to the 99% who, you know, who can glean. They know, you know, the people that are... 99% of the people know how to glean what you got to say that's good, and then just to, you know, throw the rest away. You know, you got to get the meat and throw the bones away. And nobody's perfect in their teaching. And so I thank the Lord for all you guys, 99%, who do that. And then the 1%, let's pray for me that I'll learn to, you know, just to go ahead and ignore them and move forward and not let anyone get under my skin. But, you know, I don't like to leave a stone unturned. If someone brings up a point that needs to be addressed, you know, I think, well, maybe there's lots of people that think that, and that's a wrong thought, so I want to address it sometimes. So, you know, there's a balance in that, too. Anyway, God bless you guys. I love you guys. May the peace of the gospel be with you. You, if you have repented, call on the name of the Lord, you believe he died for your sins, you ask him to forgive you of your sins, you know he rose on the third day, in the gospel message, you should have the peace of the Lord. One of the fruit of the Spirit, Galatians chapter 5, verse 22 and 23, the fruit of the Spirit, one of them is peace. I pray that God will give you his peace, that you'll be equipped with the armor of God. I'll go through it. By the grace of God, I'll make videos on it. That you can go out and do what... Stop, you know, all this foolish, crazy debates with people on YouTube, and go out there and win some people for the Lord. Go out there in your armor and defeat the enemy around you. In Jesus' name.